more ladies downstairs than upstairs. Had I been a Times critic, I would have been his publisher's nightmare.
I met him at a party.
I met him at a rather big party given by Lady Mary Ligon in her huge house in Belgrave Square.
Esme and I, being only 15, felt rather awkward and sad, really, at this party, as though it wasn't quite us. Henry took particular care to be kind and nice to us and to make us feel interesting. And that is when I first met him.
When I saw him, I met him, and then I immediately recognized him as having seen him before at nightclubs and restaurants, because I think you think that during the war, I mean, we were all sitting in shelters, you know, waiting for bombs to fall. At times we were having great little fun.
They all but got me yesterday morning when a roof gave way under me with an inferno beneath. And I saved my first life the day before yesterday in an awkward place. But I'm still here, as you see, and in rude health.
When he came off, he would go to bed and stay in bed until about tea time. And then he would get up and get dressed and have tea in Rutland Gate in the big, enormous, dust-treated house that belonged to his parents. And then we would go out for drinks, maybe to the Ritz Bar, and on to dinner at Belmaniere or somewhere, and out to a nightclub.
He was a brilliant talker, and that's why he was fascinating. Everything he said was amusing. And that, for me, that was the main thing about Henry, how amusing he was and how one laughed with him, and he much more fun than going out with one's other beau.
The first thing he did, whenever they were called out to a fire or disaster of any sort, he would go to the telephone and see if it was working.
In a bit closer.
And ring Dig up and tell her all about it.
One never knows, does one, when love will come along.
I think that all of us thought all the time that we might never wake up to another glorious morning. And there were very few girls left in London, and we all knew each other. And we would say to each other as we got ready to go out, often in each other's flats, "Who are you going out with tonight, darling?" And then we would say, "Is it someone you want to die with?" Because we had this idea that if we were killed in a nightclub, which we might well be, we would spend the rest of eternity with whichever man had been paying for our dinner. But I can think of nobody nicer to have died with than Henry.
Oh, I think he was a deeply romantic man. I think he fell in love. I don't really feel that, you know, there had to be a sort of sexual part of that. I mean, it didn't mean that he went to bed with the people, but I mean, he fell in love. And every new relationship really could sort of kickstart a novel.
What he had with me was certainly a loving friendship. He had written a story which he says was based upon a little time that we had spent together sitting in the park in the middle of the war, and he gave me the galley proofs of it as a 21st birthday present. I suspect that he must have been writing during the times when he pretended to be resting, you know, when he came off duty. But they were very productive years, and there wasn't a lot of time, and he didn't get much leave. And he was obviously bursting with writing at that time, wasn't he?
It's love I'm after. It may make me rise or make me fall, but it's love I'm after.
Brings back memories, the old disco, times we had all that. I worked with him once, yes. Only once on a heavy unit out here. He was quite good. If he was a writer, I never dreamt he was. He never mentioned it, and we never saw him write. Well, I was surprised when I heard his name was Green. We always called him the Honourable. Many other things. We thought he was a bit standoffish because he kept to himself.
It's love I'm after. It may make me rise or make me fall. But
we're in 16 Trevor Place, where my parents lived from 1942 to 58. The other inhabitant was always Pussle. But my parents never acquired a cat or bought a cat. They always borrowed a cat from somebody, and I think the cat here belonged to the people in the house opposite. He wrote loving, back, concluding, nothing, doting. Most of his books were really written here. And this is the drawing room. When my father left this room, he stopped writing altogether. He always sat here by this window in a chair very similar to this. He used really a sort of board with a blotter over it, and he used to write the books in a really a sort of notebook with leaves that came out, and he used to use the cheapest sort of plastic pen holder bound round with elastoplast because he found it difficult to grip, a very sort of cheap pen nib and ink. These were sort of placed on a table here, and I mean the routine really was that, I mean, my mother and I always suspected that some novel writing went on at work, but we didn't really know about that. But he used to arrive back here on the number 30 bus or the number 74 bus, get back about tea time, have tea, read the papers, the evening papers. He always read both evening papers. He particularly loved papers. And maybe about 6 or 6.30, he would, as he said in his radio piece, go over, and that means over to the pub over there. He'd be back for dinner about 9.30. He'd settle down in this chair and write. And this might end about 12, and he'd go off to bed. He would never say anything really about what he was writing, except that it was a novel. He'd never talk to me or my mother about it.
Let us return to the example of a man going over to the pub of an evening. How to communicate all this to the reader, then? How about this? He, I think I'll go across the way now for a drink. She, will you be long? He, why don't you come too? She, I don't think I will. Not tonight. I'm not sure I may. He, well, which is it to be? She, I needn't say now, need I? If I feel like it, I'll come over later. Notice that very often one question is answered by another, that the whole passage can be read in various ways, that the man is exasperated or bored, also that she is in one of several moods, or even in three or more moods at the same time. It is, of course, necessary to establish whether the man is a drunkard or not.
Can I help you, sir? He always seemed ill at ease, although he came in twice a day, practically every day that ever came. He just came to the bar, got his drink, took it over to that table, set it on the table, and started to walk very slowly up and down from the fireplace, not quite to the door. He was a very solitary figure. He said good evening to people, but he didn't get into conversation with anyone. We tried to talk to him, but he seemed shy of talking to anyone.
If you met him in a pub, you would never know that he was a writer. There was no way you could possibly know that. You would see him as a very talkative man who probably talked a bit too much and laughed a bit too much, who did tell funny stories. And you'd know in some way that he was in some sort of a business. But I don't think you would have really known that he was in charge of a business. You wouldn't have known that he had a sort of upper class or aristocratic background at all.
The only thing I thought was that he was aristocratic. He gave that impression. But apart from that, we had no idea at all, not any idea about his private life, except that he had a wife and a son we saw very occasionally.
Would you have been very shocked if someone had said to you, he's a writer, you know?
I'd have been delighted, because I would have felt that there was some hope in his life, because you always felt you wanted to help him. He's very good looking and such a nice chap, and he never smiled, and that would have meant that he was doing something productive.
Unfortunately, I got very deaf. That's one of the reasons I stopped writing. I can't hear what is going on in pubs and things of that kind. I got constant inspiration through listening to ordinary people talking.
Well, I started in 1946 and left in 1954. The address was George Street, Manchester Square, London West 1. Rini joined me.
1946, left in 1958. He used to start his day about 10 o'clock. He was on the first floor below, and after his manservant would bring him a bottle of gin on a tray. That was his breakfast. And then after that, he used to sort of wander into our office and have a little chat. I think he studied everybody closely, and he had all their mannerisms off. And he knew exactly what was going on in the office. You know, I used to go down to the stock cupboard with a draftsman to help me carry the books, and he used to be listening in his office along just opposite, and we didn't realise that. And when it came to party times, he used to tell us all that had been going on, the scuffling in the stock cupboard and whatnot. He's sort of listening in. I suppose he's sitting there on his own, nothing else to do. Henry in the middle, with the flower in his hair. Oh, he's holding a vase of flowers. There's me, he's got his cigarette right under my nose. And here are you hiding behind here.
Yes.
These are the people from Birmingham that he invites down for the party. Here's Henry in party mood, and he's feeling very amorous, very loving there. Sometimes he'd have his melancholy moments, and if he'd had plenty to drink, that used to cheer him up. He used to have that mannerism of turning his head as though he was listening with one ear. And I think he's listening there.
He accepted us.
Wasn't class conscious at all, was he?
No.
He put on a bit of a serious side, but he was always nicely soft to the staff. Henry was my first cousin, and I just left the army at the end of the war, and I bumped into him at a party and said I was looking for a job. And he said, well, we've got to make my father think that he's thought about this. Come and see him, and we'll see if he can say you can have a job here. And fortunately, it worked out that way. There used to be a red neon sign here announcing Milano Hotel.
Now it's getting dark, and so we ought to make a start. Say goodnight and part.
This, I remember, was the loo, not supplied by Pontifex.
There's a moon, so the road we shall know. Let us escort you home tonight. Never fear, we are here. Us in the second front of fire, there's nothing left for
here. This was the dining room. It's now the TV lounge. I suppose probably only three or four of us used to sit here while Peg served through the hatch. Smoking, of course, all the time. We were the elite guests, and Henry was treated just like a king.
Absolutely. Yes, thank heavens.
Pigs had been a musical comedy actress in a touring company of Lilac Time. The highlight of the year, really, was Peg's birthday party, and at the end, we used to come back into this room and go on chatting and drinking. And I remember once Manchester Jack, who was a salesman in jewelry and used to come here about once a fortnight, so we used to meet him quite often, But on this occasion, he came with his wife, and after the party, he hypnotized her. And she went as flat as a board, as rigid as a board, and he took the chair and he put her neck on this chair, and this chair he put her ankles. And then Henry and I got up and sat on her, and not as rigid as it could be. And then by just a flick, after we got up, she jumped up and was perfectly okay. It's the first time I've, or the only time I've ever seen hypnotism.
You must realize Canada is an awful lot of empty country. We traveled 15,000 miles in the 70 days start to finish. We slept in 36 different beds, many of them in sleeping cars, as we went from one province to the other. It was a small party, five industrialists, and your father was very much concerned with food machinery and chemical plant. He was an industrialist, and he seemed to wish us to meet him on to that level all the time. He kept us going. Only once, we were coming back from Nova Scotia in the train, traveled overnight, still going on, a lake, some rocks, a few trees, and he said, "Oh, Wilfred, what an awful country this is. There's nothing at all. I feel so depressed."
Oh, dear.
I said, "Well, never mind, Henry. We'll soon be in Montreal."
Any bears there at all? Do you remember?
Any?
Bears. Were there bears? I seem to remember him talking a bit about bears.
Bears?
Bears, yes.
It's his age, Liz. Any man as old stretches back to the bad times. He's suspect just because of the years he's lived. They won't like it. Then they'll have to swallow their silliness, she said. Why, he's famous. He's one of the ornaments of the state. Look, he explained, in the class of work your grandfather did, they're just lyric poets. After 25, they're burnt right out. He made his proof of his great theory when he was 21. And he's 76 now.
He had an idea that things were always going to go wrong. He had these little things he would say or would constantly would repeat, or they'd come into his speech, such as "one can't do right," or "there's no hope, there's no hope." He thought in the natural way of everyday life, it was just one series of mistakes after another, not so much disasters as mistakes.
They came by train to Inverness, and I think they must have got a car from there, because I can't see how he could have got the crate of gin here any other way. We had a daily routine. We carried the oars and the fishing stuff down from the house. Henry and Sebastian helped me down with the boat. They got in the boat, and I shoved them off into the unknown. To him, writing was an intuitive interior thing which was done secretly. And you moved subtly through feelings and sensations from one place to another, and you didn't have a plot or anything cut and dried. It was an inward movement. The books are written in a very peculiar style, and this style actually repels some people, but they're full of conversation. He was very good at conversation.
I had a theory that there should be more and more dialogue. I think